So good morning everyone. Today we are going to see about most important topic for your both for your pre-finals and for the PG aspirants. This is unsafe conditions of middle ear, and mostly we will be seeing about cholesteatoma and its complications. Okay, so cholesteatoma, unsafe CSOM and its complications will be a direct 10 mark question for you. Okay, so please stay kindly give your attention. So in the unsafe conditions of ear, we will be seeing about acute necrotizing otitis media and chronic otitis media squamous cell type. Okay, so this is acute. Why it has not been dealt in acute conditions means it has marginal perforation. Okay, so any marginal perforation will further lead to unsafe ear. So that's why we are dealing it here. So acute necrotizing otitis media, it is caused by beta hemolytic streptococci. Okay, beta hemolytic streptococci. This condition is characterized by patient as usually he gives the complaints of ear pain or ear discharge. Hearing loss, okay, which will be of conductive type, conductive hearing loss. So you could see here the marginal perforation. I hope you remember what is meant by the word marginal perforation. So it involves the fibrous annulus. The fibrous annulus is eroded. Okay, you could see here, this is a fibrous annulus, and here you could not see any annulus in this part. Okay, so erosion of fibrous annulus in a particular margin. Okay, it might be in the antero superior part or antero inferior or posterior superior or posterior inferior. Okay, here this is left TM. Okay, you could see the cone of light here. So this should be antero inferior, antero superior, posterior superior and posterior inferior. Okay, so you could see it is involving the main of the posterior inferior quadrant and some part of posterior superior quadrant. The margins are completely eroded. Okay, so that's why it is called as unsafe condition, and it might lead to primary cholesteatoma. Okay, so you could see again here, this is the marginal perforation. You could not see the fibrous annulus here, whereas you could clearly appreciate the fibrous annulus. Okay, so this is the fibrous annulus, but here the margins of the fibrous annulus are completely eroded. This is a condition of acute necrotizing otitis media. And you could see there, this is the middle ear mucosa, the promontory. Okay, there are no cholesteatoma flakes. Cholesteatoma flakes will appear as white CC materials if there is both marginal perforation and if there is some whitish flakes, CC materials like that, then the diagnosis will completely change into secondary cholesteatoma. That we will see it later. Okay, so it's treatment remains the same. You have to repair the tympanic membrane using the graft. Okay, so treatment, surgery remains the mainstay of treatment. Repair the tympanic membrane, and if there is any erosion of ossicles, as we saw yesterday, there is any erosion of ossicles, if there is any other thing further damages inside the middle ear, you should repair that also. Okay, so now coming to squamous cell or unsafe CSOM proper. So why it is called unsafe ear? It is called as unsafe or squamous cell or atico antral type. Okay, the word unsafe is not used nowadays. squamous cell chronic suppurative otitis media or articondral type, because of the perforation, it usually involves the attic area. Okay, perforation in attic or the superior in pars placida. Pars placida region. Okay. So unsafe or a squamous cell chronic suppurative otitis media, it is due to cholesteatoma. Cholesteatoma is not a malignancy or is not of cholesterol crystals. Okay, but it is a misnomer that of cholesteatoma. It is usually called a skin in wrong place. So in the external auditory canal, there it is lined by, I hope you remember, it is lined by keratinized stratified squamous epithelium. Okay, keratinizing epithelium is present in the external auditory canal. But this epithelium is not present. It is not present anywhere in the ear except external auditory canal. If this epithelium is present in middle ear, anywhere in the middle ear, okay, middle ear or mastoid or temporal bone, this condition is called as cholesteatoma. So how this epithelium get transported inside the middle ear? It might be due to any perforation, or there are some theories. Okay, even without the perforation, the epithelium will be inside, will go inside the middle ear. So there are some theories which are also more important. So we will see that now. So before that, this is the concept, or this is the basement that you should know. Okay, so that is the keratinizing stratified squamous epithelium, which is the epithelium of the external auditory canal, is present in the middle ear. It's present anywhere in the middle ear except the external auditory canal. Okay, so you could see that this is the bone, a fibrous stroma. Okay, so if this epithelium is present in excess in the external auditory canal, we will call that condition as keratosis obturans. Keratosis obturans, which will also present like a mass. Okay, but if it is in the middle ear, it is called as cholesteatoma. So cholesteatoma has a unique property. Why it is called unsafe, or why it is called a condition with more complication, means it has a property of bony erosion. Okay, so by eroding the overlying or underlying bone, that is your temporal bone or the mastoid bone in the posterior part of middle ear, it may lead to the infection, spread of infection from the middle ear to the adjacent areas. It may go to superior part or posterior or inferior, anywhere it may go. Okay, so that's why it is called as most unsafe, and it will lead to a number of complications. Okay, so the bony erosions are due to the cholesteatoma has properties like enzymes like collagenase, acid phosphatase, proteolytic enzymes. So these, and there are a hell number of enzymes, but these three are most important, and they contribute to bony erosion. Okay, so you could see that the bone resorption with cholesteatoma as a result of recruitment and osteoclast. So the osteoclasts are derived from bone marrow mononuclear cells. So the rank L on osteoblasts are T cells bind to receptor activator and monocytes forming osteoblasts. Okay, so this will lead to development of pro-inflammatory cytokines. Pro-inflammatory cytokines which are produced by the cholesteatoma, and it will lead to bony erosion or bone destruction. So this cholesteatoma is classified into congenital cholesteatoma, and acquired. This acquired is further classified into primary acquired cholesteatoma, and secondary acquired. Okay. So, first we will see what is congenital cholesteatoma. So, congenital, as the word implies, so it is present since the birth of the child. Okay. So, when you examine the child's ear, you could see that there is a white mass-like lesion medial to the tympanic membrane or behind the tympanic membrane. Okay, so you could see that there is no sign of any perforation. Okay, the tympanic membrane appears intact. So that is the main prerequisite of this congenital cholesteatoma. Okay, so it should be behind intact tympanic membrane. There should be no history of perforation. That means the child's mother should never complain of her. There should be no past history of any ear discharge. Okay. So this pictures might be asked as a picture based questions in your NEET MCQs and pre-final years. You people also should be know to distinguish what is congenital and what are the other types of cholesteatoma. Okay, so this is another picture of congenital cholesteatoma. You could see here also the tympanic membrane is intact, no perforation. Okay, so this is this whitish material. This is called cholesteatoma. This is the cholesteatoma mass. Okay, so next is primary acquired cholesteatoma. In the acquired cholesteatoma, it is divided into two types. Okay, primary acquired and secondary acquired. So primary acquired cholesteatoma, there should be no perforation in past tense of anywhere in the tympanic membrane, but the epithelium should travel inside. Okay, should travel from external auditory canal into the middle ear. So how this is possible? So there are a couple of theories that has been put forwarded by some people. Okay, so the first theory is Whitmack's theory. It's one of the theory of primary acquired cholesteatoma. So everyone know when the eustachian tube remains blocked, okay, it will lead to retraction of tympanic membrane. If the tympanic membrane retraction is in some other part, that is in past tense in the inferior quadrant, it won't lead to cholesteatoma. Okay, so the retraction of tympanic membrane should be in pars flaccida. There should be a retraction pocket. Pars flaccida. Retraction pocket. So, okay, so this pars flaccida is the most common site for the origin of primary acquired cholesteatoma. Okay, so this is also called as Prusak's space. I hope you remember what is Prusak's space. I'll show you a picture. So this retraction of tympanic membrane through this retraction pocket is the most common site of primary acquired. Okay, and this theory is the most accepted theory. So you could see that the eustachian tube obstruction will lead to persistent negative pressure in the middle ear. So when there is atic or posterior superior retraction pocket, it will lead to primary acquired cholesteatoma. And there are also some other theories that we'll see it later. And what is the basic of secondary acquired cholesteatoma? That is through any marginal perforation. Okay, we saw, right, acute necrotizing otitis media will cause marginal perforation. So through any marginal perforation should already be present in the tympanic membrane. Okay, so there is a pre-existing marginal perforation. marginal perforation through which the epithelium will migrate into the middle ear. Okay. So this is your secondary cholesteatoma. There are some other few theories for primary acquired cholesteatoma. That is Sadis theory. Sadis, the name where do you remember any name that we saw in the name of Sade? Any classification? Yes. Tympanic membrane retraction. I hope you remember. Okay, so it is given by past tense or retraction of tympanic membrane is given by Sade. So this another name theory for primary acquired cholesteatoma, Sade's theory. It is also called in the attic area should be considered as primary acquired cholesteatoma unless otherwise proved. Okay. This is a picture of primary acquired cholesteatoma. Pars flaccida retraction pocket. Due to persistent eustachian tube blockage. Okay. So this is the Prozac space. Okay. So I hope you remember that divisions of middle ear into epitympanum, mesotympanum, hypotympanum. So here there is malleus, the incus, and the stapes. Okay. So this area. Lateral to the malleus, okay. So this is your Prozac space. But you were at right. This is your epitympanum, your mesotympanum, and below that is hypotympanum. So this pars flaccida, this epitympanum is also called as attic. Okay, so you could see here. This whitish cheesy material right here, this is the cholesteatoma, and Prozac space is the most common space to develop primary acquired cholesteatoma. Okay, so you could see here the pars tensa or the tympanic membrane is intact. Here you could see the cholesteatoma mixed with debris, okay, in the pars flaccida or in the attic. So this is also primary acquired. Pars flaccida. So next is secondary cholesteatoma, secondary acquired cholesteatoma. So primary acquired cholesteatoma, what we saw is there should be no perforation. The epithelium should migrate from the external aortic canal into the middle ear. Okay, so for that we saw some theories like Whitmax, Sadis, and Dudis theory. For secondary acquired cholesteatoma, the epithelium should migrate from external auditory canal to middle ear, but the route is through, as I said already, through marginal perforation. Marginal perforation, which is also seen in acute necrotizing arteritis media. Okay, so through marginal perforation. So the prerequisite is margin of tympanic membrane has to be eroded. Okay, so this theory is called as Habermann's theory. Okay, Habermann's theory states that the epithelium migrates from the middle ear into the middle ear, from the external ear into the middle ear through marginal perforation. Okay, so this is secondary acquired cholecystoma. So you could see here margins are eroded and you could see the cheesy materials. The tympanic membrane is completely eroded. Okay, so these are the cholecystoma flakes. Okay, and again here the margins are eroded. You could see the cholecystoma here. Okay, so the margins are eroded. Here there is fibrous annulus. Okay, this is also secondary cholecystoma. So for PG aspirants, you should never forget the pictures, how to differentiate congenital. I think primary acquired cholecystoma was asked as a picture based questions in NEET before 1 or 2 years, before 2 years I think. Okay, so clinical features, how you say this is unsafe as commercial, what will be the condition by which a patient present to you. Okay, coming to the clinical features, the patient will complain of ear discharge. Okay, in acute suppurative arteritis media we saw the ear discharge will be more in number. Okay, will be copious, will be purulent, but here the ear discharge will be scanty, foul smelling ear discharge. It might be, sometimes it might be mixed with blood also. Mixed with blood occasionally. Okay, so bloodstained ear discharge might be his complaint. On examination, when you see the tympanic membrane, perforation will be seen in attic region of tympanic membrane. And there might be granulations will be present. Sometimes polyp, oral polyp might be also be present. Okay, so and the patient may complain of hearing loss also. But since it is unsafe and since this is most prone for complications, this type of cholecystoma or this type of ear, so there might be erosion of ossicles and which may lead to hearing loss, usually of conductive type. Okay, so what we'll see for investigations, first the patient should be examined under microscope. If there is ear discharge, first culture and sensitivity should be taken from the discharge. Okay, it should be sent for culture and sensitivity, and according to that antibiotic should be given, and your clinical examination tuning fork test. Okay, so it will show conductive hearing loss, Rennie is negative, and your Weber lateral is to same ear. Okay, I hope you remember the mnemonic socks. In sensory neural hearing loss, Weber's will be lateral is to opposite ear, and conductive hearing loss it will be lateral is to same ear, and your airborne conduction, Schwabax, all those. Okay, and in your pure tone audiogram it will show conductive hearing loss where there will be airborne conduction gap. Okay, you cannot do tympanometry because there is perforation. And for imaging, X-ray mastoids, since it is a most complicated disease, X-ray mastoids will not of no use. So HRCT temporal bone, HRCT temporal bone should be taken to view the ossicles, condition of the ossicles, mastoid air cells. So the suprachiliary temporal bone will show you the surgical indications to what to repair during the surgery. Okay. So coming to the treatment, medical management is of no use here. Okay, because you should remove the cholesteatoma from the ear. So surgical treatment is the mainstay. Surgical treatment is a mainstay of choice. So surgical treatment is divided into two types. Okay, intact canal wall mastoidectomy or canal wall down mastoidectomy. Okay, so what is intact canal wall mastoidectomy? It is a normal mastoidectomy which is done through facial recess. Okay, so facial recess, there is no cartilage. Okay, so this cannot be used for any extensive surgeries. Okay, so these are common incision used for ear surgeries, for any extensive surgeries, and most commonly for mastoidectomies, postural incision behind your ear. Okay, that is in post auricular area we are putting incision, so that is called postural or Wilde's incision. So okay, so this is intact canal wall where we are drilling. See, this is the mastoid. We start drilling in the McEwan's triangle. I hope you remember the McEwan's triangle. So we are keep on drilling through a burr, and this is the common wall between the middle ear and the posterior wall. So okay, so we are keeping this wall intact. So that's why this is called as intact canal wall. This wall is intact, and we are keeping on drilling. And once we reach the antrum, antrum is a common natural communication. So we are removing the disease through this antrum. Okay, so that's why this is called intact canal wall. So you could see the common wall is kept intact. Okay, so this is the diamond burr. This is also intact canal wall. So surgeries names, and they won't ask you every step, but you should know the concept of both the surgeries. Yes, they will ask you in the examination, in the practical examination. Okay, so this is your canal wall down. So you could not see the entire it's middle ear is made into a cavity. Okay, so the common wall is broken. So what they will do in canal wall down mastoidectomy is, this is the middle ear, the mastoid. Okay, so this, there will be wall like this. So this entire thing will be removed. Okay, this will be removed. Facial now, and it is made into a single cavity. Okay, so this is the concept behind canal wall down mastoidectomy. So while you are drilling, you could remove every disease from the middle ear. Okay, so what is the difference between a normal canal wall up and canal wall down procedure? The meatus, external artery meatus, will be normal, but in canal wall down, the meatus will be appear as widely opened meatus. Okay, it's a big meatus. Okay, so that doctor will be, the surgeon will be clearing the mastoid cavity every once or twice a year. Okay, so recurrence is highly recurrent in canal wall up procedure because there might be residual cholesteatoma. Why? Because we are not seeing this, the sinus tympani. I already told you, right? This area might, there might be disease, but in once while we are going through facial disease, we cannot access this area. So there might be residual cholesteatoma there. So there is high chance of recurrence in the canal wall up procedure. In canal wall down, there is very low rate of recurrence. Okay, it is a safe procedure. Second look surgery is not required because we are making it into a single cavity, and there won't be any recurrence. So there is not required. But here you should do a second look surgery after six months to one year. So this is not done nowadays for cholesteatoma. Okay, and for canal wall down procedure, yes, you should put a hearing aid also. Okay, So in canal wall down, I told you, radical mastoidectomy and modified radical mastoidectomy. So radical, the name itself implies it's an extensive procedure. Okay, so we will remove everything, and radical will be short drilling, and you will remove mastoid air cells. Okay, will be short drilling from the posterior wall. So first what you will see is mastoid air cells, you will remove that, then you will remove posterior canal wall. So this two steps remains the same for radical and modified radical mastoidectomy. Okay, so next is you will keep the eustachian tube closed in radical mastoidectomy, but you will keep the eustachian tube open. Okay, since we are removing everything in the radical mastoidectomy, so if what is the purpose of keeping eustachian tube open? Because it will again take the infection from the pharynx into the middle ear. So that's why we are closing eustachian tube in the radical. But in the modified radical mastoidectomy, it is a reconstruction procedure. Okay, in this we are planning to keep, we are planning to preserve everything which is not eroded. Okay, so we should preserve everything possible, everything possible in modified radical mastoidectomy. Okay, so the reconstruction is done by tympanoplasty. Tympanoplasty, I hope you remember, meningoplasty plus ossicloplasty, the erosion of ossicles using the processes we are keeping. Okay, so here we are not doing any reconstruction. Okay, so what is the main aim of surgery is, aim of surgery is to give the patient safe and dry ear, and you should reconstruct or you should preserve hearing, or you should give back hearing as much as possible. Okay, so that is the aim of surgery of cholecystoma. It is possible only in modified radical mastoidectomy. Okay, so this is most commonly done nowadays. Now coming to the final topic, which is complications. Okay, so the complications of cholecystoma. So the pathology or the pathophysiology of cholecystoma is how the disease spreads. Okay, so I already told you in the very first slide that the property of cholecystoma is bone erosion through some enzymes. Okay, so it will erode. Direct erosion of bone is the most common pathway, bony erosion. Okay, then through any congenital dehiscence or through natural openings like oval window, round window, you could see congenital aberrant arachnoid gland lesion, meningoencephalocele, through natural openings. Okay, through vascular channels. So roots of complications. So first is bony erosion. It's the most common root. It doesn't mean only chronic or only cholecystoma leads to complications. Okay, that doesn't mean like that. Even acute suppurative otitis media or acute otitis media can also lead to complications. But the point there is, acute suppurative otitis media can lead to complication through any natural route or through any already operated ear. There might be any dehiscence. Through that, it may lead to complication. But cholecystoma, it has a bone eroding property. Okay, so bony erosion is the most common cause for cholecystoma. The other route is natural openings, like oval window, through oval window, or through round window, through congenital dehiscences. Dehiscence means any deficiencies. Okay, any congenital dehiscence, or through any traumatic or iatrogenic, traumatic or surgical openings. So these are the most common route through which any conditions of middle ear will complicate. Okay, so but this bony erosion being the most common for cholecystoma. So next, even the complications are divided into intratemporal, That means within the temporal bone, okay. And other is intracranial. So once a disease spreads into the cranium, okay. So in the intratemporal, what you will be seeing is mastoiditis, labyrinthitis, vitrositis. I won't be dealing with all the complication in detail. I'll just give you a hint. I'll just give you a basic theme, okay, so that you can go back and read. Just one hour is not sufficient to deal with the entire complication in a detailed manner, okay. So intracranial complications, there is brain abscess, meningitis, okay, temporal lobe abscess. Sigmoid sinus thrombosis or lateral sinus thrombosis. Cerebellar abscess. So this is the outline of complication. So first we will see with intratemporal, okay. Intratemporal, first is mastoiditis. So you could see that the post-auricular, the ear is moved up, outward or laterally, okay. So the ear remains more prominent. Once the patient enters the clinic or enters the OP, you could see that affected ear is protruded outward, okay. And in the post-auricular region, you could see there is redness, okay. There is a swelling there. So this is called as mastoiditis, and this is the most common complication of all. So it's the most common complication, okay. So we will see the pathology, how this mastoiditis is a complication of colostomy, okay. So there is infection in the middle ear, as you all know, which through the aditus is a common complication. It goes into the mastoid, okay. So mastoid is the posterior wall of middle ear. So your medial wall, posterior wall, and here there is the mastoid, okay. So mastoid is filled with air cells. There are number of mastoid is hematized, so there are air cells, okay. So into the mastoid, once the infection enters the mastoid air cells, it's the same pathophysiology like ASOM when the eustachian tube is blocked. Okay, there we saw about the stage of eustachian tube blockage or occlusion, stage of presuppuration. The same pathogenesis, okay. Once the infection enters there, first it will lead to hyperemia and congestion. Okay. So the mastoid air cells, there will be hyperemia and congestion. Once the infection still proceeds and the mastoid air cells are hyperemia and congested, there will be exudation. Okay, exudation of fluid, exudation of pus inside the air cells. This will then, what is the next stage? Obviously, the pus has to break out. Okay, so the air cells break. And the mastoid will be filled with pus, purulent material. Okay, this everything will break. So mastoid filled with pus. This stage is called as coalescent mastoiditis. Okay. Coalescent mastoiditis. From the, once the mastoid is filled with pus, through this aditus, it will reach the pus will reach the middle ear. And from the middle ear, through perforation, it will enter External artery canal, it will appear discharge. Okay, discharge from the external artery canal. So this is the main pathophysiology of mastitis. Mastitis alone can be asked as a 5 more questions for pre-final years. Okay. So this is the another appearance of mastitis. So clinical features. How the patient will present? Okay. Patient will present with severe pain. Since there is pus there and pus breaking out, severe pain, ear discharge, high grade fever, sometimes even chills, convulsions, even convulsions can also be present due to high grade fever. Okay. On examination, what you will see is the post auricular region appears. The pinna appears protruded, okay? The pinna is protruded and the post auricular area is tender, congested. So this appearance is called as ironed out mastoid. Appears as if when you are ironing a shirt, okay? So it appears like ironed out mastoid. This is called as ironed out mastoid appearance. Okay. And when you see the external artery canal, there will be a pus. Okay. So to visualize a tympanic membrane, what you will do is mop or oral toileting will be done. So once you mop and when you again take the torch or otoscope to visualize the ear, there will be again pus filled. Pus will fill so rapidly. So this is called as reservoir sign. Okay. So you have mopped up the pus from the external artery canal, and again when you are seeing the pus has been filled so rapidly from the mastoid, okay, through the opening, there are hell lot of pus there, so that fills the external artery canal very soon. So that is called reservoir sign. And another characteristic appearance is external artery canal, the posterior wall will appear as sagging. So posterior wall will sag down. That is called sagging appearance. Okay, sagging of posterior wall. So these signs and these appearances you should never forget while studying mastitis. Okay. So as usual, investigation. What you will do is pus culture and sensitivity. Of course, before that examination under microscope. Pus culture and sensitivity, and you will do all the other investigations, tuning fork test, your proton audiogram, and coming to X-ray mastoids, which will not be that much sufficient. So you will go with HRCT temporal bone, high resolution, because of very minute structures that you need to visualize. Okay. So coming to treatment, there will be high grade fever infection. So first you should give antipyretics, analgesics for pain, and high antibiotics. Okay, antibiotics. If that doesn't settle in 48 hours, you should go with surgery. Surgery, simple mastoidectomy, or depending on the condition, you should go with modified radical mastectomy if needed. Okay, simple mastectomy is also called as cortical mastectomy. Okay, so there is pus in the mastoid. So what will be the fate of pus? So if the pus there travels, you could see the two muscles attached to mastoid are sternocleidomastoid and posterior belly of digastric. Okay, so if the pus travels through sternocleidomastoid, it will appear as abscess there. Okay, so that is called as dissolved abscess. If the pus travel the pus goes to the posterior belly of digastric, it is called as Sitelli abscess. Okay, so the pus can go superiorly through zygoma. That is called a zygomatic abscess. Posteriorly, post-auricular region, post-auricular abscess. These two are when the pus goes inferiorly, okay? And if the pus goes to external auditory canal, EAC, it is called as Luke's abscess, EAC, LUC, Luke's abscess. You can remember it like that, okay? So you could see that sternocleidomastoid mastoid and the digastric posterior belly of digastric. So the pus from the mastoid, if it travels to sternocleidomastoid mastoid, it is called, if it goes into posterior belly of digastric, it is called as Sitellus abscess. Okay. So the next is pitocytis. So pitous bone is a part of temporal bone. Pitous bone, 30 to 35% of individuals, the pitous bone will be pneumatized. Okay, so pneumatized means there will be air cells. So the same pathology as if as in mastoiditis, this air cells, when once it gets infected, okay, there will be pus. So that is the main pathology of pitocytis. So in the pitous bone apex, there will be 5th cranial nerve and 6th cranial nerve. Okay. So what will happen in pitocytis is there will be involvement of 5th nerve, because 5th nerve has 3 divisions of the maxillary mandibular. So it won't involve the entire 3 divisions. It will involve only one part of mandibular nerve, or the 5th nerve, and 6th nerve palsy will be there. And there will be persistence of ear discharge. Okay, so even because this is not so common, once the mastoid surgery has been done, even after that, if there is persistence of ear discharge with these two complaints, okay, so this is called grade negostite. Grade negostite. Okay, so this is very important. This state you should never remember. So the next complication is labyrinthitis. Labyrinthitis, the infection through the middle ear, through the opening or oval window or round window, the infection goes into inner ear. Okay. So once the inner ear is involved, there will be sensory neural hearing loss, along with, since there is tympanic membrane and everything involved, there is conductive hearing loss. So there will be mixed hearing loss in labyrinthitis, because it involves the inner ear and the condition per se is a middle ear condition. So there will be both conductive hearing loss and sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, and as usual, there will be labyrinthitis. For labyrinthitis, there will be fever, vertigo, that you should never remember. Okay, so the vestibular system, we will see later the physiology. So the functions of labyrinthitis is your balance, okay, maintaining the balance. So once that is affected, patient will experience vertigo, fever, vertigo. Okay, so the next is facial nerve palsy. Facial nerve palsy is the most important. Facial nerve is the most important nerve that runs along the medial wall into the posterior wall. So everyone are aware of the anatomy. So facial, so the condition will involve the facial nerve. Okay. So facial nerve palsy is most common. The patient will present with the deviation of angle of mouth. Or inability to close the eye, affected eye. So there will be LM and facial nerve palsy. Okay. So next, coming to intracranial complications. So intracranial complication, you could see that above the mastoid there is a pigment plate that separates from the brain. Okay. And above the brain there is dura mater, arachnoid mater, pia mater. Okay. And if it affects the extradural, it will cause extradural abscess. And once it goes inside that, it will be called a subdural abscess, meningitis. Okay. So intracranial. Intracranial complications. So the most common is meningitis. Meningitis is the most common complication. The others are extradural abscess, subdural, depending upon where the infection goes, okay? Subdural, temporal lobe. So temporal lobe abscess is the most common brain abscess. Brain abscess and CSF, okay? The next is cerebellar abscess. So we'll see very few conditions about detail in detail. So temporal lobe abscess. In temporal lobe abscess, there will be nominal aphasia. What is nominal aphasia? If you show him any object, he cannot name the object, but he will say the use of that object. For example, if you show a pen or a pencil, he will say that it is used to write or draw, but he cannot name that object. Okay, so that is nominal aphasia. And supra quadrantic homonymous hemianopia. So that is called as pie in the sky. Okay. So in both the eyes, supra quadrantic supraquadrantic, and both the eyes, same side is affected. So it is called as homonymous, okay? So it will appear as pie in the sky. And obviously there will be convulsions in temporal lobe abscess. Okay. So next is cerebellar abscess. Everyone know the function of cerebellum to maintain the balance, maintain the gait, okay? Ataxia, drunken gaits in cerebellar abscess. There will be dysmetria. Dysmetria means patient cannot evaluate, or patient cannot judge the distance. Okay, he cannot calculate the distance. And this diadochokinesia. This you would have studied in your physiology and in your medicine while you are taking your CNS cases, okay? So these are the conditions of cerebellar, specific conditions. Every condition will also include fever, okay, vertigo, convulsions. These are already present. So this is typical to cerebellar abscess. Next is your sigmoid sinus thrombosis. The thrombus, once the veins get thrombosed, okay, due to infection, this thrombus will go into mastoid emissary vein, and this will lead to obstruction. Thrombus means it will obstruct, okay? So it will appear as edema over the mastoid. This mastoiditis also will appear as same, but in this edema over mastoid, there will be tenderness of jugular vein, okay? Because the sigmoid sinus will continue as internal jugular vein. Tenderness in jugular vein. I hope you remember the anatomy. So this is called as Grazinger's sign, okay? There what you saw in petosite is Gradenigostride, okay? Here this is Grazinger's sign. Sigmoid sinus thrombosis. So there will be papilloedema in eye. Because of compression of when you compress the normal IGV, there will be papilloedema. Just one side of IGV is involved. Okay, so one side of IGV is involved, and the thrombus has obstructed the vein. And when you compress the normal side IGV, there will be papilloedema in eye. Okay, this sign is called Grobeck sign. Okay. So typical feature of sigmoid sinus thrombosis is Pickett's and fever. This is also called as hectic fever. Okay. So as usual, for all the above conditions, a symptomatic management should be given, and the main line of management will remain surgery. Okay. to take the underlying condition. Yes, that's all. Thank you for this listening to this session.